Thank you very much. So I've been asked to give a quick overview of next X-ray missions in the near and less near future. And of course, I choose some highlights from those missions that are under development at different stages with science cases relevant, especially to gamma ray burst science and in general the science that will be addressed by Hermes. And then I will also, of course, focus and give a short overview of the TCUS project, which is hopefully a main gamma ray burst mission for the future. So these are this is a summary of the areas in the gamma ray burst science that need to be further addressed by these next generation facilities. So, of course, we need to improve on the understanding of the physics and geometry of the front emission, internal engine and progenitors. So this implies, of course, advancing with respect to the current limitation of current detectors on the study of the front emission, both from the point of view of spectral and timing capabilities. Of course, we could still improve on the early afterglow emission, I also list other main topics, the use of gamma ray burst for cosmology, for multi-messenger astrophysics and fundamental physics. And this is why if we give a look, for instance, at the missions that have been selected by main agencies like ESA, just to get a flavor or indication on what is the best direction that in which gamma ray burst science should go and as a consequence, the mission, the concept for next generation missions need to be based. If we have a quick look, we see that most of the mission of the Cosmic Vision program, small, medium, and large mission, deals with planetary exoplanets or solar system exploration or cosmology, which means that the resonant keywords, so the very high level keywords that are resonant to the agencies and are, of course, of interest for the general science and for the general progress of the knowledge of mankind, mostly deal not strictly with understanding exactly what is the given emission mechanism. This is very important, of course, gamma ray burst, prompt, after the geometry, but we have to be resonant with main themes that are of interest to the worldwide and general scientific community, which are, again, cosmology, fundamental physics, and life in the universe. This is why there are so many missions also from ESA dedicated to exoplanets or to solar system exploration. So if I had to choose among these open issues in gamma ray burst science or addresses, of course the main emphasis is on gamma ray burst cosmology, multi-messenger astrophysics and fundamental physics. And this is of course, for instance, exactly there are the areas where also the Hermes science belong. And of course, we have to keep an eye to the synergy with the next generation facilities. Of course, as already discussed, for instance, Francesco, just in his last talk, the synergy with CTA, but the synergy with all the other large facilities that are being developed in the all electromagnetic domain and also multi-messenger domain are, of course, very important. And many of these facilities include gamma ray burst science or use in their main core science. So this is again to stress this synergy, so I already mentioned, I can skip this, a list of some of the, in my view, mission, X gamma ray mission that are going to be launched in the near future or are under advanced development study or for the future of the next decade. Include, of course, VOM, which is, to say, the main mission, gamma ray burst, dedicated to gamma ray burst, that is going to be launched in 2022, which is a French-Chinese collaboration, the Einstein probe, which is a mission dedicated to time domain astronomy, which also may be relevant to gamma ray burst. The JECAM, which is a gamma ray burst monitor mission, Polar, which also is aiming at advancing a our study of the polarimetric properties of gamma ray burst. Hermes and other Anatolian satellites program have already been discussed, of course, in detail in this conference. And also I would like to mention the EXTP mission, which is a mission under study, advanced study by China and Europe. Okay, so this is just a very quick overview of the SVOM. The SVOM, again, is a Chinese-French mission under development in several years, and now eventually in 2022 should be launched. And it carries on board a set of instruments that somewhat resemble and complement, so let's say they expand on the capabilities of the current SWIFT mission. So they provide, for instance, the study, detection and study of the prompt emission over a much broader energy band. So one of the limitations of SWIFT is that the gamma ray burst monitor, the BAT, has a very narrow energy band. And here, SVOM will carry on board a set of monitors, so the CLARE and the GRM, that will cover a total energy band from 4 keV, more or less, to 5 MeV. So this will be an extension with respect to SWIFT. Another advantage with respect to SWIFT will be a dedicated set of robotic telescopes on the ground to follow the gamma ray burst detected and localized by the monitor, further better localized by a small X-ray telescope based on an innovative technology, which is a microchannel plates in lobster eye configuration. And of course, this is aiming at reducing the observational inefficiencies in the follow-up in the optical near-infrared energy range of the gamma ray burst, and at the end, measuring the redshift. So if you want to say the current main limitation in the SWIFT era is the small energy band, limited energy band of for the prompt emission of SWIFT, and the main inefficiencies in all the observational process that leads at the end to the identification characterization of the optical counterpart and the measurement of the redshift. The Einstein Probe mission will be based on this innovative technology, which is using microchannel micropore optics in lobster configuration. This allows to focus X-rays, soft X-rays from 0.3 to 5, 6 kV, over a huge field of view compared to other focusing telescopes. So when we talk about focusing X-rays, we always think about alpha degree. A few degrees like Hirosite is already huge, but here we are talking about hundreds of square degrees. And they will carry on board a set of 12 of these detectors. This will allow monitoring of the soft X-ray sky with an unprecedented combination of field of view and sensitivity, which will be one or two orders of magnitude better than any other monitor. Of course, this is of interest for the general time domain astronomy, but also, of course, for gamma ray bursts, especially soft gamma ray burst or high redshift gamma ray burst, even though the lack of a real gamma ray burst monitor would make the study in detection and identification of gamma ray burst with Einstein probe quite difficult. It will also carry on board a follow-up X-ray telescope, of course. EXTP. Is a mission in which also Italy is also heavily involved. It is also partly based on the heritage of the LOFT mission that was studied by ESA and was led by Italy a few years ago for the so-called M3 selection process. And it will carry on board a set of very large area detectors at the focal plane of focusing X-ray telescopes, which will allow the spectroscopic and polarimetric measurements of sources with unprecedented sensitivity. It will also carry on board a wide field monitor, which will operate from 2 kV up to 40, 50 kV, which is based on the use of silicon leaf detectors, as well as this large area detector, 3 square meter area collimated detector that also operate from 2 to 30 kV. And this, the large area detector and the wide field monitor based on this technology, which has been developed in Italy, thanks to this very efficient and productive collaboration, which is a very nice synergy between INFN, INAF universities, which has demonstrated and now prototyped and produced the application of the use of these silicon leaf detectors for astronomy. And also Hermes, as we show, Theseus, detection technology take advantage of one of the applications of these detectors. So this will also be of interest for gamma ray burst. Again, it will detect mostly soft ones, but the capability of the Wi-Fi motor for detecting localizing a fraction of gamma ray burst and then have the study of the afterglow through the follow-up with this very large area telescope will produce, of course, an advancement in the study of X-ray flash, but also in the study of the afterglow. And the JECAM is a mission which is which will launch to set to spacecraft in the opposite side of a lower orbit, as you can see here. And the aim is to cover simultaneously the full sky, so to monitor the full sky with a set of small scintillator-based detectors. For the location of this set of instruments is still limited to one or a few degrees. It will operate in the typical energy band of detectors, but it will cover the scale simultaneously. So the main aim is to provide in a very short term, likely at the end of 2020, a means of maximizing the detection of short gamma ray burst as counterparts of gravitational wave signals. So if we go from the near future to the later future, the end of this decade or the beginning of the 30s, most of the agencies, and first of all ESA, which is ahead of all the other agencies under this respect with the TCU's mission concept, all these main agencies are and the scientific community behind them are developing, starting at different stages, a mission capable of substantially improving our capability of detecting, localizing, and identify high-resolution gamma ray burst, as well, again, providing the maximum scientific return for gravitational wave astronomy and multi-messenger astrophysics from gamma ray burst. Of course, I mentioned ATHENA, because ATHENA, the next L2 mission, large mission of ESA, has also gamma ray burst, the use of gamma ray burst as comms vision for measuring warm up intergalactic medium in absorption, using so the light of gamma ray burst as a background light for this kind of spectroscopy, but also using gamma ray burst as traces of pop 3 stars, doing an unprecedented spectroscopy in the soft X-ray. This is a simulation with the X-IFU, the integral feed unit in the X-rays of ATHENA, an absorption spectrum, a simulated absorption spectrum for a very high redshift medium bright gamma ray burst. Of course, such a mission will need a next generation gamma ray burst transient machine to provide the gamma ray burst trigger, location, and redshift. I now focus among these missions of the future, ambitious missions of the future for gamma ray burst on the TCU's Transit Energy Sky and Early Universe Surveyor. As summarized in this slide, it is being studied and developed by international full European consortium, with readily led by Italy, with UK, France, Germany, and Switzerland as main contributor, plus other several European countries, and it is a mission that was, you can find much more details on the website and on this paper on the archives. There will be very soon updated papers on the archive about the TCU's mission. So TCU's is being studied by ESA. It is undergoing a phase A study as a candidate, one of the currently two candidates for the next M5 mission, so medium mission, for as a mission, a launch in 2032. The main goals of TCU's are to eventually exploit the enormous capability of high-redshift gamma ray burst for investigating the universe, at the same time fully exploiting gamma ray burst for multi-messenger astrophysics, but more in general, providing a substantial contribution to time domain astronomy and to the full exploitation of these large facilities of the future through the whole electromagnetic domain and multi-messenger domain. Again, this is the consortium with INAF, with myself as lead proposer, so Italy coordinating the consortium, but with main contribution again by UK, France, Germany, Switzerland, and other countries that are listed here. This is the timeline. In 2018, Tunisia was selected as one of the three candidates together with SPICA and Envision. And now we are undergoing the last part of the phase A study. The phase study will end in the next spring with the mission selection review and the final decision on how the candidates. Now, as you may know, SPICA has been excluded by the process because of severe technical and programmatic issues. So now the decision is between TCUs and Envision, which is a mission to Venus. So the decision will be taken in June next year, and the launch is foreseen in 2032. So now I say a few words, more detail on the science case. I think most of you very well know the scientific motivation for substantially improving our capability of identifying and studying high-energy gamma ray bursts. Here, the main aim is to fully exploit the association of long gamma ray bursts with the explosive death of very massive stars, which live and die where they were born. So the explosion of gamma ray bursts directly trace star formation region in galaxies, in very high redshift galaxies, because these gamma ray bursts, of course, as you know, are the most bright phenomenon in the electromagnetic domain, so they can be detected up to very high redshift, as can be seen here, up to even more than 9. And the power of gamma ray bursts is that they provide a mean for directly detecting, as can be seen here. This is the near-infrared counterpart, fading counterpart of the highest redshift gamma ray burst. So being capable of detecting and localizing accurately a gamma ray burst in the X gamma ray domain at very high redshift and to follow it very efficiently with a large or medium infrared telescope sensitive enough to catch, localize, and make the redshift of this fading light provides us the mean of directly detecting an object, an exploding object, a few hundred million years after the Big Bang. So it is true that up to now there are, thanks to the Hubble Frontier Fields, and there will be, thanks to JWST or ELT, galaxies, massive, very bright galaxies detected also through lensing at this very redshift. But this is instead a mean of directly detecting an object exploding there from galaxies that are even below the detection threshold of the large facilities. This is shown here. These are six images taken by the Hubble Space Telescope after the afterglow of the gamma ray burst faded away. And as you can see, there is nothing. So you know that in this direction, there are six high redshift galaxies. You know that they exist, where they are, how many there are, and at which redshift they are. So only because we were capable of detecting, localizing, and measuring the ratio of this fading near infrared counterpart of gamma ray burst. So for instance, by simply counting this, getting a statistical sample of a redshift gamma ray burst at higher than 6, we will get relevant clues on the star formation rate evolution, which is still largely undetermined at higher than 6, even if much progress is going on and will be provided by JWST. But even most impressive is the capability of gamma ray bursts of pinpointing galaxies that are below the detection threshold or even the largest facilities of the future. And not only through a statistical sample of a redshift gamma ray burst, you will be capable of assessing and studying the population of galaxies, primordial galaxies, which are below and of the detection threshold of the Hubble Space Telescope, will be below the detection threshold of the largest facilities of the future. But also of these galaxies that are invisible, if you are quick enough to point a sensitive spectroscopic telescope on the fading counterpart before it fades away, you can, of these galaxies that is, for instance, invisible to the Hubble Space Telescope, you could understand the metallicity, the neutral hydrogen fraction, and even the properties of the intergalactic medium around the galaxy, thanks to the spectroscopy on the gamma ray burst counterpart. So this is a very unique power of gamma ray burst for understanding the star formation evolution in the universe, cosmic ionization, the bulk of the population of primordial galaxies, pop 3 stars. This is very well known, but what we lack here is a statistical sample of gamma ray burst at threshold higher than 6. Up to now, there are really a few, 6 or 7 of them in more than 15 years of operation of, for instance, of SWIFT together with several robotic telescopes on the ground and other main facilities in the world. The other aspect of the other phase of the case of TCU, as I mentioned, is to provide a substantial contribution to time domain astronomy and multi-messenger astrophysics, because while providing a substantial improvement on the detection and identification of Reshi gamma ray burst, automatically the mission will provide a survey and monitoring of the soft X-ray sky with unprecedented combination of fiduciary sensitivity, as well as a monitoring of the sky over a huge energy band up to several MeV, so being capable of detecting and localizing several classes of transients for both time domain astronomy and multi-messenger astrophysics. Just to give an example for multi-messenger astrophysics, you know very well this beautiful observational picture that emerged in 2017 and was speculated since several years, that neutron-star-neutron-star merger should produce emission of gravitational waves, but also a short gamma ray burst and possibly a kilonova emission due to radioactive decay of heavy elements being formed in the very neutron-rich and dense matter that is formed after the merger. And this picture was confirmed in 2017, thanks to the beautiful observation by LIGO, by the GBM and so on. But what TCU is aiming to do is to do all this for at least a fraction of these events, that while this observation required the efforts of many observatories and many hours or days, TCU aims at doing this by itself, detecting and localizing the short gamma ray burst down to arc minute location accuracy, detecting and localizing the possible soft X-ray emission emitted and predicted in some models by the mergers, and detecting and localizing the kilonova emission. So all these observational pictures that took, efforts of many observatories worldwide and hours or days, a mission like this would be capable of doing this, at least for a fraction of this event by itself and possibly within a few hours. The mission concept that allows to achieve such revolutionary science goals is a mission concept that, as I mentioned before, is in the mind of the worldwide gamma ray burst and transit and multi-messenger astrophysics community since several years, and is very similarly proposed under study in the United States, in China, in Japan. So we have this mission that I mentioned before, the TAP or the GAMOV in the United States, IZ Gundam in Japan, for instance, and ESA Europe with the TCU concept is ahead of all these communities, because the TCU is the study that is most advanced with respect to the other. TCU will carry on board a soft X-ray imager, which will be based again on the already mentioned cameras based on micro pore optics in lobster eye configuration that again operate only in the soft X-rays, but providing this energy band a unique and unprecedented combination of large field of view and sensitivity, as well as location accuracy better than two arc minute, but that can well go down to a few tens of arc seconds. This soft X-ray imager will be complemented, of course, because this is only for the soft X-ray part, so this plays a role mostly for very Reshi gamma ray burst and for the soft X-ray survey. But of course, we need a proper gamma ray burst detector if we want to be capable of detecting localizing any class of gamma ray burst, and also be capable of discriminating among the high number of the transient sources that are expected to be detected by the XI in the soft X-ray domain. So the other monitor is the X-gamma ray imaging spectrometer, the XGIS, which is the Italian-led instrument, which is based on a technology which, again, comes from the same research and development activities and groups that are on which also the detectors of the Hermes satellite are based, and from which also the detectors from the LAD and the WFM on EXTP, for instance, come. So this is you make use of silicon detectors coupled to scintillator detectors to cover an unprecedented energy band from 2 keV to 10 MeV. So the total energy band covered by TZUs for the prompt emission of gamma ray bursts will go from 0.3 keV up to 10 MeV. So it's something really unprecedented. We, again, also... implemented by an infrared telescope, which operates in the near infrared domain, which will be pointed to the gamma ray burst or transient detected by one or both of the monitors, thanks to the fast viewing capability of the spacecraft. And this is a sketch of the spacecraft that is still, of course, under development by the industries that are studying TZUs with ESA. Okay, this
Lorenzo,
is yes.
1 minute.
Okay, so I try to conclude in 1 minute. So the combination of this set of instruments, the monitors, the infrared telescope, and the mission profile, the viewing capability, the pointing, and so on, will provide, as is shown in this nice plot by our colleagues, Giancarlo and colleagues in Milano, will allow TZUs to detect and localize the measured redshift of all classes of gamma ray burst, high redshift, very redshift, long, short. Ultra long X-ray flashes, subluminous, all these classes that will give us, of course, a full exploitation of the gamma ray burst phenomenon. And this plots show, especially those on the right, you can appreciate in terms of gamma ray burst detected per year as a function of redshift, the huge difference and the huge advancement which will be provided by TZUs, the red line, with respect to currently achieved by SWIFT, the blue line here. Or here you can see in this luminosity redshift plane where the yellow points are the currently detected gamma ray burst and the pink, the violet ones is the population that will be unveiled by TZUs. Okay, yeah, I have to conclude then. So I stress again the capability of TZUs of detecting and localizing counterparts of Newton's time to star measures or counterparts of gravitational wave signals from this kind of sources. And of course, as I already mentioned before, the synergies with the large facility of the future, both for early universe observations, so for instance with ELT, TMT, or ATINA, or for multi-messenger and time-domain astrophysics, so with Einstein telescope or advanced like Virgo, Kagra, and so on, or neutrino detectors, and as well as the other facilities, CTA, SKL, SST, for the transient domain, are one of the main strengths of TZUs. And even finally, I would also like to stress that in addition to all these beautiful capabilities that already involve the astrophysical and scientific community at large, and the synergies are very important under this respect, TZUs will also allow for a guest observer program to fully exploit its scientific capability and to fully involve the scientific community. So this is my summary. I don't need to go through it again. Just remark again that this is the unique occasion for fully exploiting the European leadership in these fields and in the enabling technologies, and also, of course, to fully exploit the scientific cases, or to fully exploit the next generation facilities in which Europe, Italy and Europe are also investing a lot, both on the electromagnetic side and multi-messenger facilities. I, of course, invite all of you to go to the TZUs website if you want to have more details on the TZUs mission. You can also contact us and subscribe to the scientific working groups. As said, we are now working very toughly for the mission selection review, the last phase of the phase A study, which will take place in the next spring. Final decision between TZUs and Envision will be taken by the ESA Space Program Committee on June. And there will be a main international conference on TZUs in Malaga or virtual in spring 2021, depending on the evolution of the coronavirus. So I'm finished and thank you very much for the attention.